John Muir wrote those words. At the age of 11, Muir sailed from his native Scotland to the wilderness that Wisconsin still was in 1849, in time to see, with his piercing, deep blue eyes, the passenger pigeon.
I have seen flocks streaming south in the fall, so large that they were flowing over from horizon to horizon in an almost continuous stream all day long at the rate of 40 or 50 miles an hour, like a mighty river in the sky, widening, contracting, descending like falls and cataracts, and rising suddenly here and there in huge, ragged masses like high splashing spray.
He was less than 6 feet tall, and his clothes were clean, but rarely pressed. Muir wrote,
"No dogma taught by the present civilization seems to form so insuperable an obstacle in the way of right understanding of the relations which culture sustains to wilderness as that which declares that the world was made especially for the uses of men. Every animal, plant, and crystal controverts it in the plainest terms. Yet it is taught from century to century as something ever new and precious. And in the resulting darkness, the enormous conceit is allowed to go unchallenged."
John Muir had a pleasant voice, low-pitched, with a light Scottish burr. He said,
"We all travel the Milky Way together, trees and men."
When a young man, Muir had silky, long, reddish-brown hair and a beard that he never shaved. Both hair and beard had turned white by the time he died in 1914, not many months after the last passenger pigeon died in a Cincinnati zoo cage. Three decades later, Aldo Leopold spoke in his deep, gentle voice, with both sadness and hope, to planners of a passenger pigeon monument. Leopold said,
"There will always be pigeons in books and in museums. But these are effigies and images, dead to all hardships and to all delights." Book pigeons cannot dive out of a cloud to make the deer run for cover. nor clap their wings in thunderous applause of mast-laden woods. They know no urge of seasons. They feel no kiss of sun, no lash of wind and weather. They live forever by not living at all.
Leopold was born to German immigrants in a house atop a Mississippi River bluff. He wrote these words.
If the biota in the course of eons has built something we like but do not understand, then who but a fool would discard seemingly useless parts? To keep every cog and wheel is the first precaution of intelligent tinkering.
An ordinary-looking man, Leopold was always tanned from his days in the field, with a ready smile and a face deeply marked by laugh lines. Leopold wrote,
"There are some who can live without wild things, and some who cannot. Like winds and sunsets, wild things were taken for granted until progress began to do away with them. Now we face the question whether a still higher standard of living is worth its cost in things natural, wild, and free."
Leopold, of slight build but with the grace of an athlete, conceived a new ethic, a land ethic. This is what he wrote.
A thing is right only when it tends to preserve the integrity, stability, and beauty of the biotic community. It is wrong when it tends otherwise.
Despite his rimless spectacles, Aldo Leopold was quick of eye, and with his steady blue-gray gaze, he saw a different, better future. This is what Leopold saw.
For 20 centuries and longer, all civilized thought has rested upon one basic premise, that it is the destiny of man to exploit and enslave the earth. The biblical injunction to go forth and multiply is merely one of many dogmas which imply this attitude of philosophical imperialism. During the past few decades, however, a new science called ecology has been unobtrusively spreading a film of doubt over this heretofore unchallenged worldview. Ecology tells us that no animal, not even man, can be regarded as independent of his environment.
Aldo Leopold died in 1948, fighting a grass fire along the Wisconsin River near his Sand County shack, fighting to save his beloved pines.